for tuning into Mirror Now. I'm Avni Raja and you're watching Investor's Guide, a show where we make personal finance simple. We are going to break down all the concepts and help you manage your money better. So on today's episode, we are going to be talking about unit-linked insurance plans, or as they're popularly called as ULIPs. We're going to understand whether this is an investment that perhaps makes sense for you or not. What are the pros, the cons, all of that we'll talk about on this show. And joining me for more details and to understand this better is Feroz Aziz, Deputy CEO of Anand Rathi Wealth Management. Feroz, thank you so much for joining us on Investor's Guide. And over the last couple of episodes, you know, we've been breaking down various investment concepts and talking about certain products as well. But this point, as far as ULIPs is concerned, is important because there is a lot of misconception about ULIPs, whether it makes sense, it doesn't, or people investing in it without realizing. So it's important to bust all of those myths and to help people understand this entire product. So let's start by, understanding how exactly does a ULIP work.
Abni, ULIPs, as you rightly said, unit-linked insurance plans, are an investment and an insurance product combined. They try to achieve both these objectives in a certain fashion. Unit-linked insurance plans actually are a unitized method of allocating your money into another portfolio of funds or stocks or bonds or a mix of both. And a portion of the money which you invest in the ULIP is set aside for you to get the insurance cover. But this combination is called an unit-linked insurance plan. And most of all of the insurance companies offer these in the life insurance umbrella. So this is basically what a unit-linked insurance plan is. They have been a part of several people's portfolios for the last two decades, and they've gone through a large transformation as well. There have been the old avatars and the new avatars, depending on the cost they actually have for the insured.
Right. So Feroz, of course, as far as the product itself goes, or the concept of ULIPs, it's gone through multiple changes over the last several years. And now, of course, they're quite cheap. In fact, they used to be extremely expensive in terms of the kind of charges that they had. But they still, are not as cheap or as low in charges as perhaps a mutual fund is, because they have that extra charge when it comes to, the insurance part of it. So there is that premium allocation charge that we're talking about, along with the mortality charge for the insurance part. And then you also have your charge of fund management charge, which is the actual, the charge of managing the money, which goes as the investment. If you can break that part up for us, Feroz.
Avni, you rightly pointed out that the costs are higher. There are four or five heads under which these costs are established in the product and in turn passed on to the investor or the insurer, because you're trying to meet two objectives at once. So there are some costs which are fair, because a comparable product like a mutual fund for investments also has a certain cost, which is the management fee. That's a fair cost. The one unfair cost, to my mind, is the premium allocation charge, which is like an exit entry loan, which was levied way back in 2008. So it's been abolished in mutual funds for more than a decade now. But insurance policies can still have a premium allocation charge, which implies if you put 100 rupees in the policy, a portion of that, say 5 rupees, is taken as an entry loan and only 95 gets invested into the portfolio which is there for growth of your money. So there are five costs. One is the premium allocation, just like I described, where that's an entry loan. Second is the mortality charge. Mortality charge is a fair charge, to my mind, because you're getting an insurance against that cost. That's not a sunk cost. You're also getting a benefit for that cost, which is the insurance which you're getting. The fund management fee is generally a little high on the insurance side vis-a-vis the mutual funds. Third, the cost of administration is generally higher. That's the running process costs money to the manufacturer. That is passed on in full to the investor. And the last one is, when you switch money between portfolios in an insurance policy, there are some free switches which you are permitted. Beyond that, you get a cost which is called the switching cost between the two portfolios. Say if you want to move from equity to debt or vice versa, you have a certain number of free switches permitted per year. If you've exceeded those, then you get this new innovative charge of switching as well.
Right. So, Firoz, you know, just to sort of simplify it a little further for someone to understand how a ULIP works, would I be right in saying, you know, it is a combination of insurance and investment, so it works sort of like how a mutual fund works, that is one part of what you put in, works like how a mutual fund would work, and the second part works, you know, like an insurance plan would work. And you've also done some interesting research and in terms of the performance of different ULIPs as well and how they compare up as far as mutual funds are concerned. So what would be your key takeaways from this and your advice in terms of whether one should keep mutual funds and insurance or investments and insurance separate or sort of use this combination product, you know, and invest in ULIPs?
Like you said, Avni, investing and insuring yourself are two separate objectives. When you try and combine these two, you achieve both these objectives at a suboptimal level. You're not achieving both of them to their full potential. So combining a mutual fund with a term plan, which is also an insurance product, but there you don't expect any money in return. So the premiums are very, very low relative to what you have to end up paying in a ULIP. So to answer your pointed question, mutual fund and the insurance for insurance needs in the form of a term plan, if they are segregated, the value it will create for you in long periods of time is enormous, point one. Point two, which you rightly said, we did a lot of analysis because we're in the business of giving unbiased data-backed advice. So over the years of analysis of several people's life policies, not an academic analysis, life policies which come to you for a review, we reviewed close to 15,000 policies, out of which 10,000 of them were traditional plans. That's another category of products. ULIPs, about 4,800 of them we analyzed, and we realized that the return they generated after a long period of holding, close to 10 years average, was only a 2.84%. That's the kind of return you ended up making after paying for all the costs which those ULIPs actually levied on the person who invested or insured himself.
Right. So that's very important to understand, Firoz, the fact that, you know, over several years, the kind of research that you have done and the numbers it's really throwing up sort of really reiterates or drives home the point that it's important to sort of keep your investments and insurance separate. And that is something that we'll talk about more in further episodes and, you know, talk about how to break up your investments, your portfolio allocation. But on that note, on this episode, that's all the time we have. If you have any questions or any suggestions, you can write in to us as well, and we'll try and talk about all of those topics. But on the next episode, we're going to talk about gold, and this is an interesting topic because gold prices have been shooting up. So we're going to understand all of that and investing in gold on the next episode. Until then, thanks so much for watching.